Wow. So much ridiculous stuff to get here. this is a new Eternal account. Welcome to Eternal. I'm lostwolfe. The Eternal Stone stands empty, five sands of an ancient family maneuver for power. Each has a claim upon the throne, but the future remains in doubt. Change is coming to Maria. Where will you stand? With spells and swords, six guns and subterfuge, join the battle for the Eternal Throne. Your journey begins now. Start. And a whirly portal thing goes and opens up, and shazam, it drops you into a choose your avatar thing. We know I like bearded dudes, so we're going to pick a bearded dude. This is the most bearded dude we can find. Okay. You can change it at war at any time, by the way. So one of the things I mentioned when I was doing my pack opening was that the board for Eternal looks a lot like the board for Hearthstone, and I wasn't kidding. You shouldn't have come here. Don't try to stand in my way. Anyway, you play power cards to play units and spells. Power cards are a lot like land cards in Magic. You play them, and then they go into a pile. This is a little bit different than Magic, though, and I'll explain as I go along. But the whole thing is you have lands, you play them, you use the lands to cast spells and creatures. So, we have a creature, but we'll talk about him in a second. So, we've got these things called fire sigils, and you notice that they have a type line called power. That's super important. It means that they're basically lands. So, we're going to play fire sigil. You can see here you can only play on your side of the board, obviously. Par for the course. Now, watch what happens with this. It doesn't actually become a land. Summon units to attack your opponent. It doesn't actually become a land in a traditional sense, in a Magic the Gathering sense. What happens here is that you get a little token that says you have one of these. There's two separate readings here. You have X generic mana, and you have X colored mana. But it doesn't matter so much now. What matters is that we have enough to cast this guy, the Pyronite. Pyronite costs one, as you can see in the upper left-hand corner, and has a requirement of one fire. That will matter later, but for now it doesn't. He's got stats of 2-1, and we can see that he's a warrior. All useful things if we drop him down. Your move, down he goes. You have 25 health, he has 15. The object of the game, obviously, is to get him to be knocked out. We're gonna end our turn. And again, click a unit to select to attack. He is playing purple. Purple is sort of this game's equivalent of black and Magic. So we're going to attack. This game does have phases. There is a main phase, an attack phase, another main phase, and an end phase. We are now in the second, if we do this, which we're going to do, we're going to be in the second main phase. And of course, in the second main phase, you can play land. We got nothing interesting to do with that, so we pass our turn. Wasting touch, he deals 2 damage. The computer's sort of smart. It will take out things that it thinks are threats first. More warriors to avenge the fallen. Now notice an interesting thing happened here. He still has 2 of his black magic or purple magic, but he spent 1 generic mana. If you look at this, it only required 1, so he met that requirement, and it cost him 1 to cast. This guy costs 3 generic mana, but you need at least 1 red to make him happen. So we're going to throw more fuel onto the fire, and cast him. So as long as I have the 1 red, and I've got 2 other colors, say I could meet the requirement as long as I have the generic mana requirement met. This guy is a rebel. He is a rebel with a clue, maybe. Take this. Is it dangerous to go alone? Shadow Steel, he deals 5 damage to an enemy player, and then he goes up in health. And one of the greatest things about this game, as opposed to Hearthstone, is that you can actually see the graveyard. So if I click on the graveyard, you can see that he has Shadow's Grasp, and Shadow's Grasp required that he have 2 at least in his pool, but 3 generic mana to play it. 2 black, but 3 others. Okay. In most of these card games are a little bit more complicated than Hearthstone. It's good form, at least, to attack first and then do your stuff, because that way you're hiding information. So we're going to do that, and then we're going to play this. Because what it does is it makes him not aware that you have a 5-2 and you might have blocked the 3-3. Don't expect me to play strategically like this all the time. I'm not very good at it. I haven't played Magic in years. And not competitive Magic either, so... Get them! Okay. I can torch the minion to clear a path for my attack. That's kind of okay to do in this case, because he's a 4-3 and this would be very efficient. There's a 3 damage here going on. You could always just attack and he will block, and then you're saving your torch for something else. But I only do what the game wants me to, because this is sort of efficient. This is an important word at the bottom here. It says fast spell. These are kind of like Eternal's versions of instants. There are windows you can cast these in his turn, but we'll talk about that later. Now let's kill this guy and attack. These little bubbles on the left here are help bubbles. They will tell you important things like, did you know lifesteal? Units and spells with lifesteal give you health when they deal damage, healing you equal to the damage dealt. And you can tell it not to show this step again, which we're going to do. It's full of helpful advice like that, which I'm going to cheerfully ignore. You haven't won yet. Deal 2 damage. Oh, well, that's right. These other cards, I'm happy with that. Aha! A weapon to arm my warrior. There's 2 classes of weapon in Eternal. There is a regular weapon, which we're seeing here, and there's a relic weapon. We'll talk about relic weapons later. For now, all you need to understand is that this is going to add to this guy. It's going to give him 4 health and 4 attack. It costs 5. We have 5. We are good. And suddenly he's enormous and we win. Because it's a tutorial, of course. Winning, you end up getting things, so we're going to claim your reward. New cards added to your deck. We get Flash Fire, which you get 4 of. The game is reasonably good about doling out things, so this costs 5 generic mana, and you need at least 1 red in your pool to cast it. What it will do is it will deal damage equal to an enemy equal to your fire influence. The Cabal is sneaky, but if you run off their boss, the rest will turn tail and run to show them that they'll find easier picking someplace else. And that was the guy that we just... this was the guy we just killed here. This is the guy that we're going to kill, and for that we will get a reward of General Azalo. You don't have to actually click on these guys. It will just advance you by clicking play. But it's nice to know what the rewards are anyway. And that's the top end reward. But we'll talk about that when we get there. Cable Cult Leader. Cabal. It immediately adds World Pyre Phoenix to our hand, which is kind of okay. You Cabal are an aggressive bunch. Not really, they're more about subterfuge, kind of. This guy's reckless, so much like with Magic, there are keywords, and keywords have got descriptive meaning under the surface. So for example, this guy is reckless, which means that he must attack every turn. So if you come from Magic, this guy is basically like our friend, the 5-3, costs 4, the Juggernaut. He is like that. So it's going to tell me about Reckless. Oh, it's going to tell me about Flying. Oh boy. It's telling me about Flying because of that. Not enough power yet. He wants me to make pyre adept, which we will do soon. We'll talk about flying once we have some flying. Seems good, we're gonna pop down a fire adept. And now we wait a long, long time before something useful happens. Oh, killing it with three or... Okay, so... This is a... sorry, he said something and I wasn't listening. This is an important symbol to see. This means three attack or less, so kill a unit with three attack or less. That's how that reads. Ugh, I can't take many more hits like that. I'm just in time. Good, my archer will crush these rogues. We get a guy. As I say, the computer's reasonably smart. There's a 3-3 in a way, so it won't necessarily attack with its 2-1s, unless it has a plan to back it up. I think it has a plan, but let's block anyway. Because you need to see the blocking and the way it works. So what happens here is that you can see that there are two symbols here. Things that are silver are blocked. This is contested. It's a block that you are making. This is not like Hearthstone. He can't pick to attack your guys. He is picking to attack you. You are choosing to intervene. Which means that you can decide not to block or whatever it is you plan to do. If there is an uncontested guy, in other words, a guy that's going to just come in and do 2 damage, you will note that he is gold as opposed to silver. This is the blocking symbol, this is the unblocked symbol. Now, he has mana spare, so maybe he's going to do something to my guy? Nope. Should I attack with a cultist or stay back at a block? We're going to stay back to block, and the reason why we're going to do that is because we're going to go up to 4 and we're going to be open to 2 more damage. So we're just gonna sit. I don't know what he has on the other end of that, but I'm comfortable because I'll make a new guy next turn. So, even if he attacks and kills my guy, acceptable losses, that's okay. Yeah, I'm telling you that the computer is okay at doing things, and it's doing silly things. Okay, so this guy has charge. What does that mean? If I play him on my first main phase, but not my second main phase, because then I lose the ability, he will be able to attack immediately, and I can now do 7 damage. Your army is helpless to stop my flying beast. Flying. Okay, so I was talking about flying a little bit earlier. And what this means, basically, is that he is raised above everything else. Another thing I should mention that they ported over from Magic the Gathering is that this guy has Summoning Sickness. He can't do anything on his first turn until it's the second turn, and then he's, like, there and he can attack. This guy breaks that rule because he has charge. Fortunately, our Flashfire showed up right in the nick of time. So we're going to do 5 damage because he only needs 3. Play this, and we're gonna attack. In fire like this in red, this is kind of the plan you want to play. Okay. Now, I told you that I'm not always gonna be playing strategically, and I'm not, so I'm just gonna pop this down. I'm gonna wait for one of these at the second main phase, but I'm just gonna play land. Oh, we have 2 choices here. We have the World Pyre Phoenix, and we have Centaur Outrider. I'm going to play the World Pyre Phoenix because he has flying and he's reasonably large at 5-5. He has special wording. So the way flying works, and I didn't really explain it properly, is flying will fly over walkers. These guys are walkers in the same way as they will in Magic the Gathering. So long as it has a keyword like flying, it means that it will sail over those guys, hit the opponent, and nothing will happen to it unless he has another flyer. If he has another flyer, he can get in the way, stop this, and my plan is foiled. There's more wording on World Pyre Phoenix, but we won't talk about that for a little while. Kill the unit with 3 or less. Goodbye. I am fairly confident that he's not going to do anything, and even if he does kill at least one of my guys, which he may very well do, it's okay, because the Wallpine Phoenix will live. Victory! And it's added General Zalio to our hand, our deck. He is a 6/4, he costs 2 red, but 6 generic. You have quick draw on him specifically, but your other units get 2 extra attack. He is a gunslinger soldier. This particular milieu and this particular universe is all about fantasy, world west stuff. I don't really care about the story because there isn't much of a plot at all to speak of right now, but that's the kind of thing that they're aiming for. So what's quick draw? For those of you who play Magic, quick draw is like first strike, but it's very weird. Quick draw only works when it's your turn. So in other words, as long as it's your turn, you have first strike. The minute you turn your back and it's not your turn, suddenly your guy's like, ah, I've forgotten how to do things quickly, and he doesn't have quick draw anymore. The Skybreak Clan has magic. That's not actually English. The Skybreak Clan has managed to saddle up some enormous flying serpents. You never know when you'll find an ally, and we can certainly use them. You get flying and overwhelmed for beating this guy. Overwhelm we'll talk about when we actually get the card. That's okay. It's not great though. Don't try to stop me, Shaman. Shaman? Dude. Okay, so Forge Wolf has an ability that when you summon it, it deals 1 damage to enemy player just like that. And that's sort of good. And we got this as well, deal 2 damage to enemy player. Draw a fire sigil from your deck. You cannot comprehend nature's might. We're not quite at a point where we're going to do that yet because we have fire in our hand and we are happy with that. But we might want to do it, actually we might want to do it this turn because we may draw something with 3 next turn and we may just want to play it out immediately. And we got no better options anyway, and it's not like we're holding back at this point. Ah, Walkai. What is she up to? She's playing the card game like you are, guy. Deal 4 damage to an attacking enemy. Okay, so here's our first instance of a fast spell. A fast spell means that, unlike regular spells, you can play these in small windows of time during the opponent's turn. He picked to do it right after I attacked, which is the right thing to do in this case. Kind of. It's now going to tell me about those 3 things. Did I know Overwhelm? No. Did you know Quick Draw? No. None of these are channels on YouTube. Did you know Warcry? We're going to talk about Warcry in a minute. So when you put him into play, you'll see that he gets a little horn on him. And that little horn means that he has Warcry, and Warcry works like this. Every time I attack with him, it doesn't have to be a successful attack, just so long as I do attack. The top creature or the top weapon of my deck gets +1/+1. Its cost stays the same, but it gets incrementally bigger as I attack with it consistently. Which is a good thing to do with Warcry. You want to be attacking all the time. It doesn't actually matter if you're going to die. Like here, it is going to almost certainly die because it wants to take Warcry forward. I'll attack. And then surprise her with a fast spell while she blocks. That's a good plan. You've got Rampage. Give me a plus 3, 1 and Overwhelm this turn. Okay, so what does Overwhelm do? Overwhelm is this game's version of Trample. This guy has got 2 defense. And I have normally 2-1 stats. So if I run this guy into this guy, he will absorb all the damage. And this guy will die. If he had more stats, let's say he had... Let's say he had fewer stats, he was a 1-1. Even though I'm doing 2 damage to him, all the damage will get applied to this guy, and he will die instantly. If you have overwhelm, however, what will happen in that case, if he was 1/1 and this guy had overwhelm, it would mean that I would do one damage, which is enough to kill it, and the rest would spill over to my opponent. So it's okay, so the horn goes off, and the horn means that something in here got +1/+1, the top card of my deck that happened to be a creature or a weapon of some sort got +1/+1. So war cry with attack is almost always good. But what we want to do is we want to make sure that this guy survives and we can do more war cry. So we're going to do the fast spell. Aiming on our guy, he's now 5/2, that's enough to survive. And this guy takes 3 damage. He was on 21, now he's on 18, as a result of the fact that this guy was a 1/2, absorbed to the damage, and then the 3 spilled over. He drew 2 cards, that's basically what he did. Clown Snake Hatchlings. Very good. Okay, so this is so I've got 2 choices here. I've got Central Outrider, or I've got Outland Sniper, deal 2 damage. The obvious play here is to just kill this also and keep war crying and making things bigger. That may be a problem, but I'm sure our deck will deliver. Okay, so we have Overwhelm here, and we got the Centaur Outrider. I'm gonna play the Overwhelm guy, and in a rare case here, I'm not actually gonna attack. I'm gonna wait until my next turn, and hopefully he doesn't make anything else, and I'll start overwhelming and punching him in the face. In this case, it's not a good plan to run your war cry guy into that guy because it will almost certainly die. Well, that's interesting. Okay, so here's a guy that has had his stats altered by war cry, and you can tell because he's got green stats, whereas these guys have white stats. So this guy was originally a 1/1, and now he is super duper value because he costs 1, and he is a 3/3, which is great. I want to see what happens here, so I'm going to attack first before I do anything. He makes the same block, which is good. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to make this guy and then this guy. Stuns. Okay, so stuns are a thing that does not exist in Magic: The Gathering at all. Well, kind of they do. You can tap a unit and suddenly it's not doing anything useful anymore. This is sort of the equivalent. This guy is now stunned. He is tapped out and not in use for a turn. There are some cards that will keep a guy stunned forever, but this is not one of them. It will just stun an enemy unit. So when my turn rolls around, I will not be able to use it. His turn will roll around, and then when my turn rolls around again, so it's effectively 2 turns, then we can use this guy again. Play 3/1/1 Grenadin. That's alright. It's not great. Let's attack. I'm sort of hoping, yeah, he does the same thing. Good. Okay, so now my guy is open and ready for attacking. This guy gives everything else better stats, so in this one rare case, I'm going to play him before I do anything else. And then I'm just going to attack with everything. Now, there's a special thing that you can do in Eternal, which is if you press A, it will attack with everything. He makes again the same block. Good stuff. Victory. Let's claim my card. We already know what flying and overwhelm do, so I'm not going to talk about either of those things. My uncle Rolance Marshals will take you out in a blink of the eye. Iron Horn is one of his best, but if you're lucky, you just might survive. Oh, it was Iron Thorn. Sorry. Reading, how does it work? You've chosen the wrong side, Rebel. I'm here, Iron Thorn. You're Iron Thorn. I'm gonna be doing that wrong again. Anyway, so he has the white magic thingy. White, they call it influence, and as you gain influence, you can do things. This guy is just a 1/1 dork that flies. I'm gonna make lots of 1/1 dorks. This is value because we paid one and got two guys. And that's great. Oh, yay, he makes a weapon. This is now a 3/3 flyer. That's a little scary. Oh, sorry. Didn't read that. Okay, so two choices here. I can charge, or I can make more grenadin. I like my chances making grenadin more because there's more of them here. And that means there's potentially more things for him to block if I should ever be able to buff them. Yeah, sure. Ah, no, temple is fine. Okay, so there was a funny symbol there again. Let's talk about the funny symbol. This is summon, you gain one heart and draw a card. Hearts are life. And they can go either way. They can go here on creatures, or they can go on you. So, we're going to do the obvious thing and torch this guy. Torch is super duper efficient and a great card. Which means that I can do this. And I am actually just going to charge. There's no reason not to. Even if it kills this guy, it means that I can still get 3/4. Hey, flying over bomb. Very good. Now, realistically, I'm going to be keeping Outland Sniper back because there is always the potential that he might make something and I might need to kill it. So I'm going to keep Outland Sniper back. We're just going to carry on attacking. Oh, okay, so here he is equipped a relic weapon. This relic weapon will let me get into the fray myself. So what a relic weapon will do is it will allow you to attack things. And the way a relic weapon works is it's a little bit like Hearthstone's weapons, but not the same. The relic weapon doesn't count down. So you can see that there's a he has an armor value. It doesn't count down each time he attacks. What it does is it removes armor from the guy if he happens to collide with someone. So, in this case, it's a 1-1, so it will do 1 damage, it will remove 1 point of armor. So, if he's attacking me, and this is the important thing, if he clears my board and he starts attacking me directly, he keeps the 3 armor forever. The armor doesn't go down, he just keeps it forever. So, if you can get a relic weapon on a guy and you can keep his board clear, it's great, because you're doing 3 damage a turn every turn. Now, we're going to do this. Now there's a couple of choices here. I could remove some of the damage, some of the armor with my guy, but again, I don't think that's the right choice. I want to hold this back for a dude, because this is going to do the job adequately for me. The thing to note about armor, though, is that because he had 3 points of armor, I didn't get to attack him directly. I have to get rid of the armor first before I can attack him. Oh, he's playing a multicolor deck. Interesting. Enduro Bear 5000. Ah, relic weapon of my own. Okay, so I want to show you how that's going to work. So we're not actually going to equip the relic weapon quite yet. Ah, I didn't want to do that. The important thing about relic weapons, though, is that you must actually use the relic weapon to attack a creature first. So if he, well, I mean, I can attack in any order. I can attack with these three guys first, and then my relic weapon. But if he's got a guy here, I can't directly attack him. I have to attack his creature, which basically means losing my relic weapon in this case, which is not what I wanted to do. But oh well, tutorials. Oops, I should. You're right. It reminded me that I should play my power card, and I'm grateful it did. Hey, Argent Bond Soldier, good for you. And it's now very big. Okay, sure. Oh, that's alright. Along comes my fire to deal with it. Almost always in these card games, the best case scenario is when you have options and he has none, which we are at the moment. Oh, very good. Okay, so this is flying overwhelm. I'm going to hold that back until after the attack. Aha. I still have a few tricks up my sleeve. He put down what amounts to a wall. This is flying an ambush. Ambush is an effect that we've seen a little bit of on Magic cards. They call it flash there. And the way it works is that you can, it's a creature, and you can play it at any time at instant speed. So what he did was he waited for me to attack, and then he ambushed. He put this guy down, which ambush is a great word for the situation, by the way. He plopped this guy down in the middle of my attack. And, you know, make good on the fact that he could block one of my points of damage. Hey, hello, Bold Adventurer. Okay, so... Oh, relic weapon. I wonder if it's going to want me to attack with a relic weapon. Oh, no, good. Okay, so... I have two choices here. My two choices are I could play the relic weapon and attack this guy, and then attack with my 7-7, which will probably get blocked with his 0-6. Or I can attack and do 2 damage. I'm going to attack and do 2 damage because I wanted to show you how the relic weapon works. Oops, I just turned my attack off. A thing I sometimes do. Okay. Perfect. So we're going to deal 2 damage, which was what I was angling to do all the time. Okay, good news. He did not actually equip someone else. So if I have this, now notice what happens with the armor. I have 4-1. I'm going to attack him for 4. If this were Hearthstone, I would immediately lose that 1 point of armor. But it's not Hearthstone, so I get to keep this forever until he gets rid of my weapon by attacking into me. And that's, like, a little bit busted, but great at the same time. We're going to talk about what the yellow means in a little while, but... At the moment, we've got a guy who has charged, summon, play a random weapon on each of your units, of your fire units specifically. It's 8, and it has a requirement of needing 3 fire before you can get there. So even if you had 8 but not 3 fire, you can play it. This is Caleb Uncount Prince, and he is a Scion. So for beating the tutorial, you get this reward. Which is Firestarter, it's a deck. Ha! I like your style, you got guts. And that still counts for something. If you ever need somebody to have your back, just say the word. Okay, so this is an actual deck that you will get to play with. Complete the campaign. Alright, we've done it. Complete all 5 factions of the campaign. So each faction here, we beat the fire version of the campaign. Each faction is a different color, obviously. So if we go and we pick like time here, we will be dealing with a time dude, and we will have a time deck to beat that guy. So that's what we're gonna do tomorrow. I will show you that in due course. The one thing that I do wanna tell you before we even get going before tomorrow is what you should do is absolutely go into settings and where is it now? Gameplay. There is a thing called auto snap targeting arrow. Pick that, it will make your life so much easier. What it will do is instead of, well, I like it, not, I don't know if everyone else will, but what it will do is instead of just letting the cursor float around and you picking whatever, you will snap to particular people as you're moving around. So there we go. You can enable the gamepad too or disable the hotkeys and all that stuff. But this is the most important thing I think to set. Smart auto pass, I'm a little ambivalent on, but we'll talk about that when and as we get there. We're gonna accept, and that will be that. Tomorrow, I'm gonna show you one of these. Actually, I might show you a game with all of the factions because it's important to learn how they work, but we won't go through every single one of these particular guys because basically you fight the same four battles over and over again, basically, until the end. So tomorrow that is what we'll do. Thank you so much for joining me. This is episode one of Eternal, and I hope you enjoy it as much as I enjoy Eternal. I shall see you all tomorrow night when we start taking these guys and their factions down. Have a great evening, folks, and good night for now.